Hi, ladies and gentlemen, thank you and welcome to your English program, Levi's Talk. Today we are again very happy to be in front of you. But let's start with gospel. Men of God, God has given you a wonderful message and a permission to go around the world to make all the world his disciples. But you are limiting your message only where French and Lingala are spoken. What about English-speaking countries? Your message needs to go very well. Meanwhile, we have so many English-speaking countries in the world, but your message has not yet reached them. Please join us, and in that moment, we're going to break the limits, we're going to break the boundaries, and we're going to send your message very far. You are not only concerned about Congolese people who speak French and Lingala, you are concerned about everybody in the world. I mean, you need to use all the languages possible. Today we have a privilege to receive for you a man of God who is originally from Nigeria, that is Bishop Darlington Ogbonna. With him we discuss the topic, how to achieve your God-given destiny. Each of us has a destiny from God. The main concern is how to achieve yours. If you go the wrong way, you may not be able to achieve your destiny. So Bishop Darlington gives us some keys to make it possible. Listen to him and discover what he said. Hello, Bishop Darlington Ogbonna.
Yeah, how are you?
Fine. We have a privilege to receive you today.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, Bishop Darlington Ogbonna is the founder and senior pastor of the Redeemed Embassy International. So with him today, we're going to discuss the topic about how to achieve your God-given destiny. Man of God,
yeah.
The first question is, what is destiny?
I'm happy to be here today, and I want God's people to be blessed. God bless you wherever you're watching. The first thing is that we have to be able to define destiny very well. Destiny, like the dictionary says, destiny is the preordained or the predetermined events in the life of a man by God. What God has destined in the life of a man before he was born. And in the book of Jeremiah, chapter 1, verse 4 to 5, the Bible says, "Before I formed thee in the belly, I knew thee. Before your mother and father even came together to have you, you have been existing in the mind of God. You are not an accident. God knows you. Your parents may not be prepared for your birth, but God has a program for you. God knows you." So the Bible says, even before you got into your mother's belly, God knew you. And it says, "And before thou camest forth out of the womb, I have sanctified you, and I ordained thee a prophet to the nations." So you discover, when we read this part of the Bible, you discover that God knew you before even your father and mother came together to have you. They may not be prepared for you, but God knows that you are coming. And you have come with a mission. You have come with a thing to do on earth. You are not an accident. So God said to Jeremiah, before your mother and father got together to have you, God knew you. And God has a specific assignment for you as a prophet. In the book of Jeremiah chapter 29 verse 11, the Bible says that, "For I know the thoughts that I think towards you, said the Lord, the thought of peace and not of evil, to give you an expected end." There is an end. There is an end that God has prepared for you, that God is promising that he will take you through all the hurdles of life to be able to get there. So there's a plan for your life. You are not an accident. And that is it. That is destiny.
Yes, good. It is good to have a destiny. But yeah, the main problem is to know how to achieve your destiny.
Okay, that's a very wonderful question. Like I said, everybody has a destiny, a preordained program by God for each person. Now, to achieve destiny is very large, is very, very wild, but I'm going to try and give some points, some key points. You know, the first thing I think to achieve destiny is One has to involve God in all that he does. In everything you're doing as a child of God, God must be involved. In the book of 2 Kings, the Bible talked about a woman, I think chapter 4. The Bible talked about a woman who was a wife of the sons of the prophet. And the Bible says that the husband died, even though he feared God. He died and he left a lot of debt. And the Bible says when the people he borrowed money from came to collect the children to work as slaves, the woman did certain things that made her come out of a situation, out of a problem. And that is where I took the keys for success. The first thing is she involved God. She talked to the man of God about the situation. Involve God in all that you do. The Bible says in the book of Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5 and 6, it says, "Trust in the Lord with all thine heart. Lean not unto thy own understanding. And in all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy path." So if you want God to direct your path, you have to acknowledge him in all that you do. The reason a lot of people fail is because they refuse to accept God, to associate God in what they do. Now, when you put God in what you do, the first thing is that God begins to direct your footsteps. He knows you. Remember what we read in the book of Jeremiah? It says that he knew you before you were born, before you got into your mother's womb. So he is the one that knows you better, and he's the one that gives you the mission on earth. So he knows how to help you get to your destiny. So the first thing is you must associate God in all you do. That is the first and the most important first, is to associate God. The second thing that you must do to be able to achieve your God-given destiny is that you don't allow your yesterday's misfortune to determine your tomorrow or your future. Don't ever allow your yesterday misfortunes to determine your future. Yes, a lot of things have gone wrong in your life. Yes, a lot of things may not have been the best, but God has a plan. Even the hurdles of life, even the situations of life has a way of packaging you to achieve your God-given destiny. So what am I trying to say? In every man's life, we have the past, we have the present, and we have the future. The past is gone. You can't change it. You remember what happened to this woman? The past is that she had a husband who died and left a lot of debt, and right now the children are about to be taken. So she said, no, I won't allow my yesterday's failure. I won't allow what happened yesterday to affect my future. I have a great future. I believe in what God is saying about me. I won't allow what happened yesterday, because I lost my husband, because I lost so much in the past, to affect my future. So she believed. She was positive about what she wanted. She knew what she wanted. She wanted a change. She wanted something better. So she said she must get it. And that's why she approached God to get the solution. And the second, she said, no, I won't allow my yesterday's misfortune to determine my future. The past is past. You can't change it. You can't change the past. It's gone. You can't change it. But the one thing that the past can give to you, it can give to you experience. Mm-hmm. You can learn from the past. You can learn from your mistakes. You can learn from what you've been through. And you can now begin to look into, what do I do to be able to achieve my God-given destiny in the future?
Amen.
So the second thing, like I said, is to forget about what has happened to you in the past and look forward into the future. Do you know that almost 85% of all the successful stories in the world are people who came from background, from the backside of the street. People who have been through hell and high water. People who have been through all kinds of problems. And God, with God, they were able to move to the top. Can you imagine that? Thomas Edison failed 9,099 times before he could get the light bulb functioning. If he has gotten tired in the first step, we won't have the light bulb today. But he continued. He refused to take no for an answer. He said, no, I must continue. And finally, wow, today we celebrate him. So everything you are going through cannot stop God's plan for your life. Look forward into the future. bury the past, forget about the past, and look forward into the future. Let me tell you something. You might have gone through some certain things in your life, but it cannot disturb the program of God for you. So I want you to know that you have, every human being on earth has 24 hours. You can't continue to give excuses. You can't continue to say, no, because I've been through this, because I've been through that. No. There are many women who have been widows, who were widows at that moment. And a lot of them died without changing their destiny. But this woman said, no, even though I'm a widow, something can still happen.
Mm-hmm.
Something positive can still happen. And that's how she got it. So in your life, just have this thing at the back of your mind. Every human being has 24 hours. The eagle is not the biggest bird. The lion is not the biggest animal in the forest. But something made them succeed, made them become the best, is because of the way God fashioned them. God has fashioned you for success. God has fashioned you to achieve a great destiny. And you cannot go back on that. I think that's one of the things that is very, very important when it comes to destiny. Then the third thing, like I said, is so much, but the third thing that I can hit on is know and use your talents and gifts well. The man of God said to her, what do you have in your house? What do you have?
A little oil.
He said, I have just a little.
Mm-hmm.
Nothing. A lot of us don't achieve our God-given destiny because we neglect or we have negligence on what God has put in us.
Mm-hmm.
You feel like being like Him,
mm-hmm,
when God has put something in you that is more than what He has put in other people. So just discover what God has put in you and know how to maximize it. Because that's the problem. If you know how to maximize what God has put in you, if you can be able to discover the gift and the talents that God has put in you and begin to use them. God, in His omniscience, in His all-knowing person as a God, He knows that everybody may not have the opportunity to go to school. When God was creating man, He has put certain things in you. The Bible says He put treasures in earthen vessels. We are earthen vessels, but there are treasures in us. So those treasures, you have to dig down inside and bring it out. Today, we talk about footballers like Ronaldo, like Eto and the rest of them. The world does not know them today because they went to a school. We know them today because they discovered what God has put into them and they begin to use them. So there's a gift in you. There's something God has put in you and you have to learn to use it. And then I'm talking about work. Work. You have to be able to work. Work out what God has put in you. Work is one of the most important or the most essential gifts that God has given to man. And if you know how to use it, you will become somebody in life. I think that's one of the main points that I can say for today. These three things, maybe we might continue in some other time to come, but I think these three things, if you can hold it, if you can associate God in what you do, don't allow your yesterday's misfortune to determine your tomorrow. If you can know how to use your gifts and your talents well, I want to tell you that God will take you to the level you never imagined. I want to just encourage people of God. God loves you. No matter what you're going through, don't give up on yourself. There's a great future ahead of you, and together we will see it happen. God bless you.
Thank you. Thank you. Yes, but can you say something about how important is people around us? How important they can play the role in 2 minutes?
Like I said, it's so many.
Mm-hmm.
One of the points is also about relationship.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when the woman said she had nothing, the man of God said, go to your neighbors.
Mm-hmm.
Go and ask for vessels. That's talking about relationship. Relationship is so important when it comes to destiny. There are people in your life that can help you move forward. There are people in your life that if you get to them, they will kill what God has put into you. So you have to be able to choose the kind of relationship. Choose the kind of people you work with. Don't work with anybody. You can't expect to go far and still work with any kind of person. You have to choose who you want to work with, and God will help you get to the destiny. God bless you.
Yes, thank you very much. Yeah. If I can sum up what you said, the first thing you said, you have to involve God in everything you do.
Yeah.
The second thing you said was you don't have a
don't
a
allow
your yesterday's don't
allow
failure
your yesterday's failure to determine,
your future.
Yeah.
The third thing you said,
you
know
have to
your
know
talent.
How to use your gifts and your talents.
Yes, and the last thing you said.
And the last is relationship. You have to know how to pick the people you put in your life.
That's so important. Ladies and gentlemen, you can see that we still have a lot to learn from this man of God. But I give you the appointment for next time, for the next number, and he's going to continue and say more about how to achieve your God-given destiny.
Thank you.
But for today, goodbye.
In our section on education, we have a privilege today because Levi's Talk talked to Professor Dr. Raymond SANGABAU from the University of Kinshasa in English department. Our talk was around the role of the English language in DRC higher education. And this professor answered many questions we're going to discover in this VTR.
Coming to your question about the role of or the place of the English course in academic level at the University of Kinshasa or any other university in DRC, it's a kind of response to the rise of English to the position of the world lingua franca. So everywhere in the world, and thanks to its power, its capacity to be the world lingua franca, then the DRC government has given a response to make the English course a over-general course across the country, across universities, across faculties, across departments. What type of English do they need? University students need an EAP course. Which is English for academic purposes. And English for academic purposes is a branch of ESP, which is English for specific purposes. That is to say that the course is tailored on the need of the student, on the need of the specific group, that kind of English which is needed. There are many reasons, as I said. The first reason is that they need an English course, which is ESP or EAP, and it has a twofold. They have to study two things. First, they have to study a language, and then they have to study subjects. That is, there will be a combination between the four language skills plus additional skills, because they have to discuss topics of their interest. So first, I said, it is a world lingua franca, which is to say that English is nowadays a requirement everywhere in the world. Let us see what Gradol says. Gradol says in China, elsewhere in Asia, in Latin America, across Europe and many other places, English is now seen as a new basic skill which all children require if they are to fully participate in the 21st century civil society. It's a requirement. They need it so that they can be active participants. Because if you can't make it if you can't speak English nowadays. I don't know what you're going to do with technology, with the research, with scientific research, with communication, with tourism, with politics, with business. What are you going to do without English? That is the first reason. Second reason is that the learning of English nowadays is no more a matter of prestige, of learning a language, but it's rather an acquisition of a key, of an important key, to unlock opportunities across the world. That's the third reason. Oh, many problems. I made my research on that. Briefly speaking, I may categorize problem in three. The first category of problems, you meet them with your own students. The second category, the teacher. And the third one, the institution, the government. Let's come with the first category, the students. Many of our students ignore the role of the English language. They don't know what English is. Imagine someone coming from Dibayalubwe over there, coming from Kabeyakamanga, coming from Bulungu there. They don't really see what English is. And that is different with a student from Kinshasa, you see? A student from Bukavu, a student from Goma, a student from Butembo, where contact with the English people is really open. You see, some students don't really know what is the real role of the English language. Ignorance. The second problem for students is that many of our students have poor background in English. They've never got a good teacher somewhere else, across the country. Poor background, and you have problems to teach such kind of students. And another problem might be for our students, their level of life. They don't have books. They don't have dictionaries. They have nothing to support their learning. That is a problem for the students. And the second category of problems is linked to the teacher himself. Many teachers are also ignorant of the role of the course. Many, I don't know really the number, but you would see kind of teaching general English that we have been doing in secondary schools. So English for no specific purpose. English for no specific purpose. And that kind of English is taught poorly, and it gives poor results because of lack of motivation. Because students aren't going to be motivated. And when you teach something without motivation, you know what the result is. So poor material, material which are poorly designed, that's a course on material design. If you design your material poorly, then it will produce poor results. And the last category is problems related to the institution, the organizing institutions. Classroom layout. You see how our classrooms are laid out. So students sitting in a bench where there is communication is made very difficult. without equipment, without data projector, without books, without dictionaries, without materials, without new technologies in our classrooms. You see, all that, of course, in all the categories that I've spoken about, you take that of perception. How do the stakeholders, they consider what English is, what the English course is? I had a question in one of my research here, asking deans, asking academic secretaries, saying, what if a student failed in English and another one failed in a specific discipline? What punishment? What does that student deserve? And they said, oh, for English, okay, no problem, but he can't fail in a specific lesson. You see, so the kind of perception that somehow English is perceived as being lower class than other disciplines, that's a problem. That's a problem. So that's a problem of ignorance, too. Of course, the problem should be solved at all levels, as I said. So solve the problem with the students, solve the problem with teachers, solve the problem with the government, with institutions. How to solve the problem with students? Their parents should have money to afford what the students need for their classes. Of course, the problem of that problem of perception has to be solved by the teacher, who need to motivate, to make the students aware of the role of English language, as to change the perception. And remember, in my PhD, I'm suggesting an approach which is any. Which is language awareness, needs analysis, interactivity of the lessons, and evaluation. So if the teacher goes through all the steps, the perception himself is going to prepare the lesson, is going to design the material as a MSP course. And then for the institutions, for the governments, they have to arrange infrastructures, they have to buy equipment, they have, this is the time for globalization. We have to use new technologies so that the course can be taught with international standards. Oh, there is a lot to say there. It hasn't been, I've published an article in Great Britain with ITOEFL. That decision has been implemented at 30%. 30%. And that's the problem of perception, because up to now, many people did not understand why that decree was signed, and they don't respect it. They don't implement that. They need follow-up measures. They need, a government is government. So when they decide, they need people to follow up. They need deans, faculty deans, they need academic secretary generals to follow up that decree, which is an important thing for the Democratic Republic of Congo. Last word first, I would like to thank you for this, because I know that stakeholders, governments, decision makers, students themselves, and whoever who can help the country, Congo has got partners Americans, British people, South African and other English-speaking countries who are more developed than Congo who can help. So this message can reach them. Know that we are facing many problems. Whoever can help, and also thank you for giving me opportunities.
Now it is time to learn.
Unit 5. The Hotel Doorman.
Good morning, Peter.
Good morning, sir.
Nice day, Peter?
Yes, sir. It's a very nice day.
Good afternoon, Peter.
Good afternoon, madam.
Is the hotel full?
No, madam. It's half full.
Thank you.
Good evening, Peter.
Good evening, sir.
Is Miss Margaret at the hotel?
No, sir. She's not here.
Are you sure?
Yes, sir. Your daughter is out.
And my wife, is she at the hotel?
Yes, sir. Mrs. Bradshaw is here.
Thank you, Peter. Are you English, Peter?
No, sir. I'm from India.
Ah, a very interesting country. Bye, Peter. I'm tired. I'm off to bed.
Good night, sir. Sleep well.
Thank you, Peter.
Now, let's go to the English alphabet. The English alphabet. Il est important de savoir qu'en anglais, nous avons 26 lettres. Parmi ces 26 lettres, nous avons 6 voyelles. Nous avons 20 consonnes. Et ne soyez pas étonnés qu'en anglais, nous avons 48 sons. C'est-à-dire, chaque lettre peut produire plusieurs sons. Alors, listen and repeat. Écoutez et répétez. A. B. C. D, E, F, G, H, I, J, K, L, M, N, O, P, Q, R, S, T, U, V, W, X, Y, Z, Z. Donc en anglais, on peut dire Z, on peut aussi dire Z. S'il vous plaît, lorsque vous prononcez G en anglais, il faut avoir l'intention de J et dites G. Et lorsque vous prononcez J en anglais, il faut avoir l'intention de G et dites J. Donc G en anglais, c'est G et J en anglais, c'est J. Conversation. What's your name, please?
My name is Messia.
How do you spell that?
It's M-E-S-S-I-A.
That's right. Thank you. Répétons encore.
What's your name, please?
My name is Messia.
How do you spell that?
It's M-E-S-S-I-A. That's right. Thank you. Exercise. Complete this conversation and practice with a partner. Complétez cette conversation et pratiquez avec un partenaire. What's your name? How do you spell that? Pratiquez avec votre partenaire. Merci beaucoup. Maintenant, il faut épeler ces mots. Spell these nouns. Nous avons manchanga. Nous avons intertextuality. Nous avons bibliology. Et nous avons congratulations. Thank you very much. Now, daily expressions. Nous avons maintenant quelques expressions journalières qui vont avec comment donner son nom. On peut dire My name is Levi's Ney. Je peux encore dire People call me Levi's Ney.
Ou encore, I am known by the name of Levi's name. Soit, on peut dire, I am okay with Levi's name. Et enfin, on peut aussi dire, I go by the name of Levi's name. Ce sont là d'autres façons qu'on peut utiliser pour parler de son nom, pour donner son nom à quelqu'un. Je sais que vous êtes habitué à dire my name is, alors cette fois-ci, il faut un peu changer. Proverbs. Proverbs. Maintenant, prenons quelques proverbes aujourd'hui. Mesdames et messieurs, je sais que vous aimez les proverbes. C'est là où se cache la sagesse. Charity begins home. C'est pour dire la charité bien ordonnée commence par soi-même. Charity begins home. Moderation is the best policy. Moderation is the best policy. C'est pour dire tout excès nuit. Nous avons encore. Two heads are better than one. Two heads are better than one. Cela veut dire mieux vaut deux qu'un. Et enfin, nous avons a little knowledge is a very dangerous thing. A little knowledge is a very dangerous thing. C'est pour dire une petite connaissance ou une connaissance douteuse est très dangereuse. Mesdames et messieurs, merci de nous avoir suivis. Pratiquez chaque jour. Lisez chaque jour. Et le meilleur est à venir. The best is yet to come. Thank you.
Unit 7. The Medical Conference.
Good morning. Is the medical conference here?
Yes, it is. What's your name, please?
Dr. Asfahan. A-S-F-A-H-A-N.
And your address, please?
I'm from BSc in Bombay.
Thank you, doctor. Welcome to the conference. Good morning, madam.
Good morning.
Your name, please?
My name is Dr. Margaret Reynolds.
Can you spell it, please?
R-E-Y-N-O-L-D-S.
Are you American?
Yes, I'm from the States.
Where from in the States, please?
From New York.
Your address in New York, please?
I'm with Dubarry Instruments. That's D-U-B-A-R-R-Y.
Thank you, madam. Welcome to the conference.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. It was a pleasure for us to see you today. Please, don't hesitate. Anytime you need something, you have something to share with people of God, please contact us. If you are interested in gospel, you are men of God, don't be hesitated. Verpaturage is open. Levi's Talk is open, and we are very ready to receive you. Do you have an interesting topic? Don't hesitate. Call us. Write to us on WhatsApp, on Facebook. We're going to answer, and you're going to come here and share what you know. You know, you have a very important message that God gave to you. You don't have to keep it for yourself. It has to go across the country and wind out around the world. Thank you for watching us, and see you next time for the next number.